Hello, my dear friends, I am Prashant Mavani and I warmly welcome all of you in this platform of Study IQ, in which we are going to discuss and analyze important items that are published in Press Information Bureau. Dear friends, the day today is 6th September 2017 and the day is Wednesday. And before moving ahead, let me remind you that on 8th of September, that is after 2 days, the 30% discount that is given to all the students who order pen drive and tablet courses will come to an end. So if you have not ordered it yet, then I would request all of you to do it as soon as possible. If you have any question or any queries, then feel free to shout out on this number, or you can also surf our website, on which we do provide chat support as well. Dear friends, today we have many things to discuss about, and I was wondering how I can make this interaction with you more productive, more understanding based, and I was also working on that, how I can make it, I can design this interaction in such a way that it enhances your capacity. The reason why I emphasize on capacity building and understanding is because if you observe the changes, right, it is very well known that for cracking civil services exam conducted by UPSC, it is not the range of information. That's what they say in their notification as well, and if you analyze their past papers, then you will find that it is not the range of information, it is the in-depth analytical skill and understanding that matters a lot. And this is applicable to other exams as well, like State Public Service Commission exams, right? This is also coming into the banks exams and SSC level exams as well. So understanding is the key, and that's what my whole effort is regarding this discussion. Today I am very happy to talk to you about Ujjala scheme. This scheme is working under Ministry of Power, and let me remind you that Ujjala scheme is different from Ujjwala. Ujjwala is related with LPG, that is liquefied petroleum gas, and Ujjala is related with providing LED, that is LED bulbs in very cheap or affordable prices. The full form of Ujjala is Unnat Jyoti by Affordable Lightning for All. The good thing is that this scheme of Government of India is being implemented in Malaysia as well. This indicates that this scheme is a success story. In fact, there are many other countries who are following the other policies and initiative taken by Modi government. In this one we also have JAM, that is Jandan, Aadhaar and Mobile. We have talked about it, how 360 million people got direct benefit transfer, leakages were stopped because of using technologies and innovative solution. Dear friends, it also reminds me of the time I was imagining that what it would have been during the time when human beings first invented fire. No doubt fire provided us a protection from wild animals, the food that we were not able to eat in its raw form, we were able to eat it after the invention of fire, because we started roasting it and cooking it. This has expanded our menu on the plate, and from apart from that, it was also working as a protection in the cold weather. These are some of the basic things that you might have heard and understood in your early years of schooling. From that point of time till now, at present we are living in a world where we have modern electric bulbs, isn't it? And we are moving ahead from modern electric bulbs. Now we are moving towards LED electric bulbs. It also reminds me, or I was also wondering that one of the most, that's what I believe, that the biggest change or the biggest innovation that fire provided to the mankind is it provided us extra time. Earlier it might have happened that by the night human beings would have to rush to their caves, to their safe location, because of many of the nocturnal animals, hunting animals or predator animals roaming around in jungle. But after the invention of fire, they were able to work as well till the late night. They can scan the jungles and they can They can learn things about the nightlife of jungle, and from there we have been using. At present, there are many cities that do not sleep at all. That means light is not only providing us bulbs are not only providing us light, it is also enhancing, or it is providing us extra time in our hand. It also reminds me of Thomas Alva Edison, his numerous efforts to create modern bulbs. He has failed many times, right? He failed many times, but one of the most interesting thing, or you can say a direct relation between Thomas Alva Edison and all of you who are preparing for various competitive exam, is that we do fail every single day, right? We set a target. Many a times it happens that we are not able to achieve that target, but the next day we are again coming up with new target, and this is ideal way of living, right? You set your goals higher and you try to achieve them, and if you are not achieving them, then you analyze your analyze the things that that were making it non-achievable, and then you improve them, and then you move ahead. Dear friends, with modern bulbs, I would like to share one more thought with you, that see, the science of making LED bulbs and science of making other bulbs is universal, but the technology can be made local. We can customize the technology as per the need of local, as per the local needs, isn't it? If our country, if we require, if we have not provided electricity connection, then we have to see whether we can provide solar lanterns to the villages. And this program was working in many Naxalite affected areas, and these are the solutions, right? So the technology can be customized, and if we are able to implement it, if we are able to find solution, if we are able to customize it in a way that it can solve our problem, then that itself is an art, isn't it? Now, through Ujwala Yojana, it is Ujala Yojana, with the help of this Yojana, light has reached, or you can say that light has arrived to many dark places. And I also see this is the angle through which I see that there is no darkness at all, right? It is just the absence of light. The time when you turn on the switch, the darkness is immediately gone out of your room. So it is the light that we have to spread, and the darkness will automatically vanish. It also this Ujala Yojana, we don't know the results yet, but we can safely say that there would be many future APJ Abdul Kalam, many Kovind ji, many Sumitra Mahajan ji, there would be many students and many people who would be working under this light, who can work for longer hours because of light, and they themselves in future can become a source of illumination for others. Dear friends, as I told you, it is a happy news, and it is a matter of pride for all of us how a small change. The story goes like this, that there was someone was supposed to change a bulb in Prime Minister's office, and that person used LED bulb instead, and from here the whole idea generated. This is where you find innovation. Creativity comes from all the sides. The only condition is you have to keep your eyes and ears open, and then it became a full-fledged schemes. You'd be surprised to know that even developed countries like United Kingdom are also following our Ujala scheme, and now it is Malaysia. This is what I call understanding and the power of observation. 21st century civil servants should have a good understanding of the problems, of the strength, of the weaknesses, of the threats, and they should have good observation power. They should be able to find local solutions. They should be able to implement the local technology. They should be able to implement and customize local technology and solve the problems of the millions and millions of people of our country. If you look it through another way, then I can also provide you the rule of demand and supply. It is applicable, absolutely applicable over here, because the thing is that if we customize, or you can say that if we develop economies of scale, starting from generation of something or the raw material. In this context, it is electricity, and we can keep it in the supply side, and here you have demand side. If you are using ordinary bulbs, then naturally you would require more supply of electricity. That means you have to produce more electricity. But if you are efficient in using a user end, then your supply would also the dependence or the heavy amount of supply will also become efficient. And we know that any sort of developmental project, may it be solar power, may it be hydroelectric power generation projects, there are always some sort of drawbacks, right? You have to build dams, and when you build dams, then you not only destroy parts of forest, but it is also detrimental to flora and fauna and fishes and other things as well. So if we can, with all this innovative technology, if we can make it more efficient, the whole process, the whole channel, if we can make it efficient, then we can save our planet as well. And in the same context, imagine India will be saving 2.75 crore ton of carbon dioxide emission every year after the implementation, complete implementation of Ujala Yojana. For Malaysia, it is going to save 19,000 ton of carbon emission per year. This is itself a big achievement, particularly in the time when, in the time in which we are seeing drastic changes taking place in our natural environment. The second important topic is regarding smart city. Here, a mention of PPP, that is public-private partnership, is mentioned here. Pragati is also mentioned here. So let's first understand what smart city is all about. Central government, that is Narendra Modi government, has launched a project or a scheme for developing 100 smart cities in our country. Now, there is no fixed definition at a global level that what an ideal smart city should be like. The definition or the requirement of European smart city would be totally different from the requirement or the definition of Indian smart city. But basically, Indian smart city has four pillars. One is building institutions, that is the local administration, building physical, that includes all the connectivity and mobility projects, social and economical institutions or projects. If we break down these four pillars, then we find that water supply, it is very important for our day-to-day use, for our sustaining life. It is very important that cities have good source of and adequate source of water supply. It is also important that water is recycled. Electricity, we have talked about bulbs. Now, at present, you and I are interacting on a digital platform. I will throw a question: is it possible without a good supply or a 24/7 supply of electricity? Not at all. Apart from that, your other e-governances project and everything will come to a hold. Your traffic system, many of the things will come to a hold if we don't have electricity supply. Then sanitation, directly related with your health, and solid waste management. It is also, sanitation provides good opportunity for tourism and economic development, and solid waste management is something that India is working on at par with. We are taking help of many developed countries like Netherlands and Switzerland, who are converting maximum amount of their solid waste. They are using solid waste for organic as organic fertilizer. They are producing energy out of it. And urban mobility, we have recently seen how Mumbai came to a chokehold after its public transportation failed because of incessant rain. So urban mobility should be designed, cycling areas should be provided, or cycling lane, bus lane, traffic management. These are important things. These are the drivers of roads, and through connectivity and urban mobility, the urban area, which are generally, or the cities, which are known as the growth engine of our nation, they should have free flow of commutation. Public transportation system, metros, port taxis, and then you should also have last mile connectivity. So these are the things that will be developed under smart city. Affordable housing for all. We know that slum is a big problem for our country. In fact, one of the biggest slums that you can find in Asia are found in Mumbai. And we know very well that they are den of smugglers. Many crimes are associated with it. Apart from that, there are many diseases, and government is spending a lot to improve the living condition. And for that, the solution is providing affordable houses for poor people. By providing houses, by providing shelter, we are not only building confidence in poor people, but we are also giving them an opportunity to live a life full of dignity. IT connectivity, you can connect e-commerce, you can connect mobile facilities, or all the e-health, telemedicine, tele-education. Everything is possible only when you have good internet connectivity. Good governance again is part of e-governance, and e-governance is possible when you have electricity and IT facilities. Sustainable environment. I'm sure you might have experienced this many a time if you are living in a bigger city, that out of this crowded life of city, many a times we feel that to connect with nature, because that's what we used to do, or our ancestors used to do. They were connected with nature. So if you have good parks where you can sit down, meditate, hang around, do jogging or exercise, where you can breathe some fresh air, if you have green cover around your cities, then this will also help in mitigating or absorbing carbon dioxide in the atmosphere. Safety for elderly, children and women. CCTV cameras, electronic facilities, or safety facilities and rest areas, and these are the things. Playground areas, safe playground areas. So these are also part of smart city. And yes, of course, health and education. Now, Pragati platform, dear friends, Pragati is a very innovative platform started by Narendra Modi ji. It stands for proactive governance and timely implementation. This platform uniquely bundles three latest technologies. One is digital data management, video conferencing, and geospatial technology. What happens is, at every third Wednesday of every month, the Prime Minister with the secretaries of government, of all government ministries, and the chief secretaries of all the states, they interact with each other on this digital platform. And in this platform, the best practices are shared by each other. They all come together. All the projects that are in process, the projects which are in pipeline, if there is any grievances, then this are addressed to time-bound implementation, as it says. And proactive governments, that means that being proactive rather than reactive. So this is the main aim, and this is helping India. It is helping in achieving all the project targets. Apart from this, this sort of questions are directly asked in your prelims exam as well. You might be asked like the full form of Pragati platform, so you should know that it stands for proactive governance and timely implementation. Apart from that, dear friends, we know when GST was talked about, it was the word that you might have heard. I'm sure it's cooperative federalism. The reason is that the way GST Council is designed, so far all the decisions that are taken by GST, they have not used the voting system. Everything is done by understanding. So this GST itself is a good example of cooperative federalism. And the second good example is Pragati platform, because it is bringing secretaries of states and central secretaries, and they are working together and sharing and learning from each other. Public-private partnership. Now, from the name itself, you can understand that public-private partnership means a partnership between public, that means government organization, and private organization. Now, why it is in news, or why we see quite oftenly PPP model, which is also known as PPP model, we here and there find it in newspapers. And the PPP model, one of the good thing about it is that the synergies, or the energy, or the strength of private sector can be utilized for developmental projects. Now, private sector, we know that the environment is quite professional over there. They have expert human resources, they have good managers, good project managers, their project management and timely completion is also good. They use latest technology. I'm giving you some general overview of private sector, how private sector works. And above all, private sector does not have to go through lengthy bureaucracy or bureaucratic decision making process. So everything is done quite speedily in proper manner. And when we talk about the role of government, then government can identify the needs of citizen. It can decide what is good for the citizens of our country. It can do e-auctions through which it can select the best players, the most competitive one, and the best out of best can be selected. Land acquisition and all these things can be easily done by government, when I say easily, and guarantee of return is also there, so private investor can be provided an assurance that they will not lose the money that they have invested in the project. In short, government can work as a facilitator. So when this strength of both this area, both this sector, private and public sector, comes together, there becomes a synergy. Synergy basically means 1 plus 1, when you add it, it does not become 2, it becomes 3. That means you get more out of it. So this is the beauty of PPP model. Moving on, dear friends, and hopefully I will find many of you in near future in this sort of interaction, and it would be a very proud day for all of us of the Study IQ and all my colleagues. This time the news is that IRS, Indian Revenue Service professionals, interacted with President Kovindji. Now on this interaction, President Kovindji talked about the importance of collection of revenue, right, in nation building. He has said that collection of revenue is critical to the task of nation building. Now I have observed many a times that students who are not coming from commercial backgrounds, who have opted for arts or science, many a times they find the subject of economics quite difficult, and many a times I have seen that they are quite frightened about it as well. Then let me tell you, the dear friends, economics is the theoretical things that you study from books and other sources, right? But economy, if you want to understand economy, then you have to have a practical eye. If you start taking examples from your real life, then you will find that it becomes very easy to understand economy. Now if you talk about importance or critical role played by the revenue collection, then I will give you a small example here. Imagine a breadwinner of your family. Either it could be your mom or your dad, or it could be both. Now they will provide you education, they will provide you health facilities, they will take you to picnics as well, from which you will learn, you will gather experience regarding life, and this is possible when they have a reliable source of revenue, when they have a good job or business, or if they are engaged in a profession through which they can sustain the family, right? So in same way, the government as a family, if you think as government as a father or mother, then it has to, it works other way around. The source, main source of income for the government is from the tax that it collects from individuals, then it collects from business organization, and many times when you buy things, products like a packet of biscuit, or when you recharge your mobile phone with when you top up your mobile phone with a chota recharge, at that point of time as well you have seen that service tax is collected. All this taxes goes to the government. Now once the government has revenue, then it will start implementing, it will start spending the same way your parents used to spend or are spending behind you for your development. So that's how, this is how it becomes, it plays a critical role in nation building. With this small example, you can understand that revenue system, or understanding the whole structure, it becomes very easy, right? Moving on, dear friends, President Kovindji has also provided a very good example from Kautilya's Arthashastra. You might have heard about Kautilya. He's also known as Chanakya. He was associated with Chandragupta Maurya, who is the grandfather of Ashok the Great, and he has said that the way a honeybee collects nectar from the flower, and the quantity collected by the honeybee is in a fixed or limited quantity, right? It does not suck away the whole nectar from a flower. It takes what is required. It takes appropriate quantity, and that's how tax should be. Tax should be appropriate. Its rate should be appropriate. They should not be detrimental. He has also mentioned about GST. Now we know that many benefits of GST, like after implementation of GST, our nation has become one market. It is also said that one nation one tax. That means that if you buy a packet of biscuit from Gujarat or if you buy it from Jammu and Kashmir, the tax that is levied on indirect tax that is levied on this packet of biscuit would be same all across our country. Earlier the things used to be different. After coming of GST, the cascading effect, that is tax on tax, right? You pay tax on one thing, then it goes to the say for example it is manufactured here, then someone adds value, then tax was added on already added tax. So this was eventually increasing the price of the final products and services, but GST has eliminated this cascading effect, because of which the prices of generally speaking the prices has come down, which is beneficial for the poor people of our country. It is also helping in fighting pollution. Now you would be thinking how GST can fight pollution. The thing is that before, what used to happen is the trucks entering from different state has to wait in a long queue, and because of this perishable items were getting destroyed, like vegetable, fruits and fishes. And apart from that, this stop and start process of trucks used to add extra cost, and it was again a source of pollution. But now they can seamlessly go from one state to another, and all of this is adding revenue collection in the kitty of government as well. Prime Minister as well has talked about GST in his recent BRICS summit, and the reason why he has highlighted it is because the past image of India was not that good. India was considered a land with complicated tax structures, particularly for the foreign investors. They used to find our structure quite complicated, and this was a big hindrance for them to come and work or come and establish their business in our country. Apart from that, it was also very volatile. Volatile in the sense today you have 10%, tomorrow you will find that the product or the business in which you are engaged in, the tax has gone up, and if a competitor is producing the same service or product in another country, say for example China, and if the tax structure is predictable over there, then rise in tax prices in India will directly impact the competition. The Chinese producer will win, and that will impact the whole business scenario. The current scenario after implementation of GST and other measures taken by the government has become smooth. It has become technological driven. It is more transparent and it is more predictable, which is one of the basic requirement for providing an easy environment of doing business. It is also, as I told you, will add to the competitive feature of our country. And with the increase in ease of doing business and the more competitive environment we provide, we get more trade and investment opportunities, and with this we can create more jobs, more development can be done, and the revenue of the government can be increased in this way, which can be spent for other developmental processes. This itself, dear friends, now you can relate this thing with the role of Indian Revenue Service officer, right? This is the main role. This is how IRS officers can help in nation building. This is the power of civil services, the way they do work. If they are credible, if IRS officers are credible, then the whole tax system becomes credible. Apart from that, there is a small item here for you guys. It is known as CP Grams, right? CP Grams stands for Centralized Public Grievance Redress and Monitoring System. We know how grievances, particularly in the lower bureaucracy, when you go there to file a complaint, then it takes ages for them to react on it. To sort out this problem, central government has started Centralized Public Grievance Redress Monitoring System. It is software based. You can file complaints online. It is applicable to all the departments of central government, all the ministries of central government, and it is applicable to all the state ministries and departments as well. The good thing is that all citizens, and including armed force personnel, can use and place their grievances on this platform. And I think that this question can be, this is an important topic for your prelims examination, and if you want to use it for your how government is trying to solve the grievance procedure or you can say channelized grievance procedure, then this is a good example. CPGRAMS is the thing that you should remember. Moving on to another topic, that is India-Myanmar. We have talked about it earlier as well. I will quickly take you to the important things that are taking place. In 2014, Prime Minister visited ASEAN. Prime Minister took part in the ASEAN summit, and this is for the first time that Narendra Modi ji is visiting Myanmar as a for particularly bilateral. It is a specific bilateral visit. He has appreciated the courageous leadership of Myanmar peace process. He is pointing towards Aung San Suu Kyi. We know that she is a Nobel laureate, and the way she has struggled for the democracy in Myanmar has won her praises from all around the world. Apart from that, Prime Minister has also expressed pain regarding the situation that is going on in the Rakhine area. We have talked about it in our The Hindu analysis in detail regarding the condition of Rohingyas, who Rohingyas are, how it is going to be, how it can impact India, and as a constitution, as a nation, how it is our duty to protect these people. Apart from that, Prime Minister has said that democratic experience of India can be very much useful for Myanmar. India is building capacity of Myanmar in different areas like executive, legislature, election commission and press council. We have recently seen what happened in Kenya. We have known that election commission of Kenya is not that much trustworthy, and because of that, wrong leaders are getting elected. So and we know that election commission of India is a very strong and a very reputed institution, and if both election commission of India and Myanmar are working together, then definitely it is going to be beneficial for Myanmar. Apart from that, security, as we are neighbors, any security challenge of India or Myanmar is going to impact each other, so it is very important that we work together. Prime Minister has specifically highlighted Kaladan project. Now, what Kaladan project is all about, dear friends, if you locate Siliguri area, or that is also known as Chicken Snack area, it is a very small corridor, it is hilly area, so naturally you can understand that transportation facility or providing transport and the whole supply of northeastern state is passed through this small corridor. Because it is hilly area and you have lots of goods to take on, it becomes a bit expensive because of traffic jams, and perishable items also get destroyed. And to find the solution, what we have done is we have done this multimodal project. Multimodal means you are using road and waterways, both source of transportation. So from Howrah, we are going to directly take it via waterway to Sitwe port. From Sitwe, this is the river Kaladan. It will travel here for 158 km upstream in small boats in rivers. And from here, it will be laden on a road and trucks. And from here, it will be brought to northeastern state of our country. So that's how Prime Minister has decided to provide necessity supplies and increase the economic development of northeastern states. Apart from that, he has also mentioned that 40 citizens of Myanmar who were in jail will be released today as a goodwill gesture. India is also building Myanmar Institution of Information Technology and Advanced Center for Agriculture Research and Education, which is going to add to the human resource development of Myanmar. As a goodwill gesture, again, Prime Minister has gifted the research proposal that was done by Aung San Suu Kyi in 1986. This is the research proposal which we have gifted it back to Myanmar, and Prime Minister visited Anand Temple. Anand temples are Buddhist temple. They are 12th century old temple, and in 2016, because of earthquake, many temples and pagodas of Myanmar were they found some sort of damage. So Archaeological Survey of India is facelifting them, and you would be glad to know that Archaeological Survey of India is working in other countries as well, in Afghanistan, Cambodia, Laos, Vietnam. And I beg your pardon for this thing. This is not only bringing us together, it is not only increasing people-to-people contact, but it is also a way to keep the history alive and keep the connections going. With this, dear friends, I would like to end this discussion here. As I told you, I would like to remind you again that 8th September, that is after 2 days, the 30% discount that is available on pen drive and tablet courses will be taken off. So please go ahead, don't wait for anyone. Give us a call if you have any doubts, or log on to our website and you can order pen drive and tablet courses, which are absolutely necessary for your preparation. With this, dear friends, I would like to also let you know that you would be able to download this lecture from our website and our Telegram channel. Do not forget to subscribe our channel, share this lecture with your friends and family, pass me your like, and do pass me your valuable comment. With this, I, Prashant Mauni, would like to take your permission to say goodbye to you. I will see you all tomorrow. Till then, enjoy your studies. Jai Hind.